Welcome everyone. SUEZ in association with Biospectrum Asia welcomes you to the SUEZ Water Technologies and Solutions webinar on TOC and conductivity applications in the pharmaceutical industry. Now, total organic carbon or TOC and conductivity analysis can be used in a variety of applications and are very useful in assessing cleanliness, water quality and process performance in pharmaceutical facilities. It is compulsory for manufacturers to abide by the regulations for TOC and conductivity. However, not all end users understand how the technology works and why it is important. Well, in this webinar, we'll provide you an introduction to TOC and conductivity applications and provide secrets for success from the user's perspective. And to do so, we have on board with us an expert, Rohit Chakravarti, who is the lead application specialist with SUEZ Water Technologies and Solutions, responsible for providing application support in India, SAARC, and ASEAN region for the SUEZ product line. Over to you, Rohit.
Yeah, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Myself, Rohit Chakravarti, and I look after the application support for SUEZ TOC for Asia Pacific region. So I would like to welcome you all today to the session, and I'm glad you took time out of your busy schedule. So before jumping into the topic, just to give you a brief about what our company is and what do we do. So we were earlier part of GE Water Division, where in 2017, the water division from GE was divested and it was taken over by SUEZ, which is another French water giant company in the world. You might all have heard about SUEZ Canal. So now we belong, the water division of GE belongs to SUEZ, and in that water division there are three verticals, out of which we represent the analytical instruments, wherein we manufacture the total organic carbon instruments, which is our core technology. Recently this year we have also come up with a new instrument which is for testing the bacterial endotoxin in pharmaceutical and medical devices industry. So these are our core technologies that we do, but mainly and key product that we have is total organic carbon instruments. So we are based out of Boulder, Colorado in USA, and approximately we are 250 employees globally. All our instruments, standards and consumables are being manufactured in that facility itself, and everything is exported out of US. So coming to the subject, which is total organic carbon, I'm sure everyone knows what organic carbon is, and I won't be spending much time, but I'll be just brushing off. So the carbon family is split into two types, inorganic and organic carbon. Organic carbon, which is of main focus and key importance in pharmaceuticals and biopharmaceutical industry, is further split into NPOC and POC. Now, what do I mean by non-purgeable and purgeable organic carbon? So what do I mean by purgeable organic carbon is any organic carbon that can be converted to CO2 by just purging an inert gas in water is called as purgeable or volatile organic carbon. So it means that whatever carbon is dissolved inside the water, if it comes out by just purging inert gas, such molecules or such organic carbons are called as volatile or purgeable organic carbon. Whereas non-purgeable organic carbon means that even after purging, the organic carbon is not getting converted to CO2. So I have to give an extra oxidation step like combustion or UV oxidation and then purge it or then take it out to convert the organic carbon to CO2. Such molecules of organic carbon are called as non-purgeable organic carbon. So actually TOC is NPOC plus POC. So what is organic carbon? In a gist, any molecule where carbon hydrogen are covalently bonded to each other and upon oxidation they convert themselves to CO2 is called as organic carbon. It is naturally present everywhere. It is found in algae, sediments, nature, particles in water, etc. And the content of organic carbon varies from region to region and season to season as well. Why testing TOC in water is important? Because water is the key raw material in pharmaceutical formulation and API manufacturing. TOC is actually a measure of purity of water. So if TOC is higher, the organic carbon content is higher, that means the water is not so pure or water is not so purified, which is suited to use for pharmaceutical formulation and medicine manufacturing. In why organic carbon is of importance? Because as we all know that the microbes present inside the water is actually thriving on the organic carbons to grow and multiply. And thus controlling the organic carbon becomes very important. So any TOC instrument that you find that measures TOC, all the TOC instrument works on three basic steps. The first step is sample, which is your water. Now, depending on application of industry, now TOC is not only limited to pharma and biopharma, it's also limited, it's also having applications in semicon industry, it's also having application in industrial wastewater, chloralkali, boiler condensate, feed and other stuff. But today's topic is restricted only to pharmaceutical topics. So here the raw material is actually nothing but the ultra pure water that you're manufacturing. So it can be purified water or water for injection. Then you have to measure the organic carbon present in water. So what do we do is we do oxidation. So oxidation can be further split into two parts, dry oxidation and wet oxidation. Dry oxidation is nothing but combustion, whereas wet oxidation is by help of UV. So what do I mean by oxidation? Oxidation is nothing but converting the organic carbon to CO2. It can be, the conversion can be by heat, by breaking the organics and oxidizing them, or it can be because of UV. While again, UV is a light, light is energy. So UV will break the organics and oxidize them, and ultimately the byproduct of oxidation of organic carbon is always CO2 plus H2O. And once the CO2 is generated, we have to measure how much is the amount of CO2. So that measurement can be done either optically or conductivity change measurement. So if the oxidation is by dry methods like combustion, then the measurement or the detection becomes optical by using NDI detectors. If the oxidation is done by UV, in such cases it's called as wet, it is called as wet oxidation. So the measurement or checking the conversion of organics to CO2 is done by checking the change in conductivity. So any TOC manufacturing company will operate in these three basic steps. So moving on to the first technology, discussing combustion. So in combustion technology, just a brief to give how it works is you have a furnace. So this furnace, what is furnace? Furnace is nothing but a heat generating instrument. In this furnace, we have a combustion tube. The combustion tube is embedded inside the furnace. And here you can see some purple color beads. So these beads are nothing but platinum, which is catalyst. So traditional combustion methods, if you see, are actually operating at 1200 degrees Celsius, 1100 degrees Celsius. But because of introduction of platinum, the rate of reaction increases, and also the temperature operation has been almost reduced by 40%. So nowadays the combustion instruments are working and operating at 683 when platinum is being used as a catalyst. So what happens here is sample comes from the top, which is your water, and the furnace and the combustion tube is preheated at 683 degrees. Now after that, what happens, once the sample, which is your water, comes in at such high temperature, all the organics get broken down and get oxidized, and they form CO2. As we all know, the CO2 is the byproduct. Now CO2 being a very heavy gas, it gets stuck here, and once it is stuck here, it has to be pushed to the NDIR detector. Now NDIR is nothing but non-dispersive infrared detector. So this detector will measure how much is the amount of CO2 present, and based on the amount of CO2 generated, it will determine how much is the amount of organic carbon present inside the sample. So the more amount of CO2 is directly proportional to the amount of organic carbon present. So, but what happens is CO2, which is generated, is very heavy in weight, and it can't travel against gravity to the NDIR by itself. So they need a help of carrying them. So that's the reason carrier gas is used. Now, what is a carrier gas? Carrier gas is any gas which will push the carbon dioxide to the NDIR detector. It will carry, in short, but it should also not by itself have any CO2 traces, because if it has CO2 traces, it will also contribute to the overestimation of the organic carbon, and thus the NDIR detector will read CO2 with whether it is coming from the carrier gas itself or it is coming from the sample. So that's the reason carrier gas has to be pure as possible. So usually the most commonly used carrier gas is nitrogen, which is inert in nature, And there are two ways where nitrogen can be used. Either you can buy the cylinders, or you can have a nitrogen generation pump. By so that's how nitrogen is generated. So nitrogen will carry the CO2 and push it to the NDIR, and then NDIR will determine how much is the amount of carbon dioxide present, and it will form a peak. And based on the peak height and area, it will give you an estimation of how much is the organic carbon present inside. So this is how combustion technology works. Now this is actually a PDF file, so that's the reason this is already being shown here. In my PowerPoint, it actually comes as an animation. So what happens is there are few drawbacks and challenges, and there are some positive aspects of this technology. The first drawback is you always need a carrier gas. Without carrier gas, this technology cannot function by itself. Because as simply as we discussed, CO2 by itself cannot travel to NDIR. The next drawback is carryover, because what happens is if you see this apparatus, this is actually a very simplified structure that I have shown. It's more complex structure, but this is just to simplify the discussion here today, because I won't be spending much time on discussing this technology. So why carryover is a big issue in combustion? Because as you see, the combustion tube which is embedded here, there is no waste line. Usually, whosoever has been using combustion, we have got a feedback from our customers where they stopped using combustion. They say that combustion oxidation is usually 85% to 90% recovery that they get in combustion, which means that 10% to 15% of samples are not recovered. When I say it's not recovered, it means that it has not been oxidized, so it's still inside the combustion tube. So for example, I'm using the same instrument for two different applications. One is cleaning application and one is water monitoring application. The cleaning samples usually are very high in TOC. It can range in 1 ppm, 2 ppm, 5 ppm, 10 ppm, depending on what the product is. So suppose if I have a 5 ppm sample, or maybe even 2 ppm sample if I take, just to be conservative. 2 ppm sample, 10 to 15% of 2 ppm is approximately 200-250 ppb. So 200-250 ppb of the product is still inside the combustion tube, and next if you introduce your purified water, which is usually you get 50 or 80 or 100 ppb, now you're getting actually 300 or 350 ppb as a result. Still you are well below 500 ppb of compendial limit, but then it would be suspicious to you, like, why have you received such high TOC? Because your online TOC might show you water which is 10 or 20 ppb, and lab TOC is always higher, but then the sample which is showing 20 ppb online and showing 350 ppb offline is something is a matter of concern. So either you will doubt your online TOC and then you will start investigating. So this is one of the key drawbacks of this technology, where there is no waste discharge line. Because if there is no waste discharge line, whatever is unoxidized or unrecovered will lie inside the combustion tube. And next, whenever low TOC sample is introduced, it will get carried over and it will add up to the result. The third key issue here is the calibration stability. The calibration stability that I have heard from the industry is just 3 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks, or max to max 4 weeks if there are not much sample. So in that case, it becomes 12 to 15 or 20 calibrations in a year. So, and calibration, as we all know, has to be done with good standards, good quality standards like USP grade standards. So doing 15, 20 calibrations in a year with such expensive standards, again, the cost of operation goes up. And now the fourth key point is cost of operation. It's because of frequently using the USP grade standards for calibration, using carrier gas as a thing to push the CO2, and also the high power consumption of the instrument. So these are the key reasons why cost of operation actually goes up. The only positive of combustion instruments that we see is the capability to handle solid samples, but then the problem here is that it's not required in pharmaceutical. It's mainly a key application, environmental and soil analysis, where scientists are using the soil to check the fertility and organic content, and then they dose the nitrogen, phosphates and organics based on the amount of organic carbon content in the soil sample. So it's of no use in pharmaceutical as such. So moving on to the next technology, which is direct conductometric principle. So this is now the wet oxidation that we are discussing. So in this wet oxidation principle, UV is the key oxidizing agent here. So initially we discussed in combustion, the key oxidizing agent was heat. Here it is light energy or UV energy. So what happens is sample comes in from the left, which is your water. The initial conductivity or the raw conductivity of the sample is measured. And then it passes through a quartz coil. And in between the quartz coil, you can see here a tube kind of structure. This tube is nothing but the UV lamp. So when it is passing through the quartz coil, it is exposed to UV. And while it is exposed to UV, all the organics bonds are broken down because of UV energy. And it gets converted to CO2. Now this CO2, which is present inside the water, as it is not dry oxidation, everything is happening in water in ambient temperature. So CO2 mixes with OH minus ions in water and it forms bicarbonate ions. So there are new ionic species which are generated because of UV exposure, which is bicarbonate ions. And then because of new ionic species generated, the final conductivity of water is high. And then we measure the final conductivity of water, and then we take a difference of final minus initial conductivity, and we get the difference in conductivity. So here the difference in conductivity suggests that the difference in conductivity is because of UV exposure, where organics got oxidized and converted to CO2. So based on the difference in conductivity's value, they are converted to TOC value, and that's how the differential direct conductivity principle works. So I'll just show you the animation here. So the sample comes in from the top, and as you can see, the blue colored balls, those are actually the organic carbon. And then in between, you can see this lamp kind of structure. This is the UV lamp. But now because of UV lamp, this molecules which are present in water will get broken down. Now everything is not organic in nature here. So as it gets broken down, you can see the red colored balls. Red colored balls are actually CO2, and then they mix with OH minus ions. They form green colored balls, which are bicarbonate ions. But apart from green and red, you can also see the gray and dark gray colored balls. Those are actually other impurities present inside the water, like nitrates, sulfates, phosphates, because water will have those naturally. So this technology has a drawback of also false measuring the other interfering ions as well, which is nitrates, sulfates, phosphates, chlorides, whatever is present in your water. So the key drawback, as I said, we measure the final minus initial conductivity. And here the key drawback is that there might be some other molecules also which are having lower bond energy as compared to UV. And now when they're exposed to UV, the UV breaks everything inside. It's not only organics, it also can break any other molecule which is having a lower bond energy as compared to UV. So here the final conductivity will measure everything. So there is no filter of separating the conductivity from organics versus the conductivity from the inorganics, or not inorganics, but some other molecules or other ionic species like nitrates, phosphates and sulfates. So what are we unique with? We do have one technology working. We have one instrument working on the previous technology. But then that was purely designed to compete with the other UV based instruments available in the market. So this is how UV works. Water in presence of UV will form OH radicals, and OH free radicals will interact with organics and it will form CO2. This CO2 will further mix with OH minus ions in water, and it will form bicarbonate ions. And that's how we measure the change in conductivity. Now here you can see persulfate. So ammonium persulfate is used as the catalyst when the TOC of the sample goes beyond 2 ppm. So we have two different instruments for the application. One instrument is only for pure water application, where the limit is 500 ppb, but the instrument can go up to 2.5 ppm. So that is only having UV. But we also have instruments which are for cleaning applications and plastic leachable and extractable applications, where the application range is higher. In that case, UV alone is not enough to oxidize. It also needs a catalyst. Like in combustion, platinum is also used as a catalyst. Here we are using ammonium persulfate as a catalyst. So how are we unique? We are unique. We are using the same principle, same technology as the plate chlorides and others. So as we can see, sample comes from the left. Upon exposure to UV, you can see different colored balls, gray, dark gray, and red. But now we have a membrane in between. This is a patented technology that we have. Though the patent has expired 5 years back, no one is able to recreate this membrane again. So this membrane is selective only to carbon dioxide, and the carbon dioxide crosses on the other side, which is this loop is called as DI loop or deionized loop. And now, as I said, CO2 cannot remain as gas for a longer time in water. It's a reversible reaction. It forms a bicarbonate ions by mixing with OH minus ions. And here you can see that green colored balls, and these green colored balls are now measured here. The conductivity is measured here. And now whatever conductivity we see here is coming only from bicarbonate, which has come from CO2, and CO2, which has come from the organics. Rest, all the interfering ions are going back, are going out to the waste. So here we are solving the problem of both the technologies. The previous technology, which was having a problem of false leak, and that's the key thing. We have overcome the drawback of both the principles together with our technology, which is called as membrane conductometric principle. And this membrane is patented membrane. It's not a consumable. It will never choke, because I have this question a lot of times from customers that what's the life of this membrane? The membrane is supposed to last for a lifetime, provided you maintain the instruments as per our recommendation. There are no pores which are there inside the membrane for which it will choke. It's a purely CO2 selective, a gas exchange membrane where only carbon dioxide can pass. Now, if anyone has a question how it is selective only to CO2, well, you can Google the membrane sievers, membrane conductometric technology, and the entire patent study can be found out, and you can read it if you are interested to know. But usually, it's a Teflon coated and hydrophobic in nature, the membrane material. It's not a consumable. So this is how we operate, and this is how this is what our technology is. It's not moving to the next slide. Ankit, am I audible now? I guess I lost my connection. Fine. So moving on to the validation topic. Now, we are the only TOC manufacturer who gives complete validation as per ICS-Q2-R1 and USP-1225. So this is, and that's the reason we are providing a premium to our customers with the performance qualification. So we do the entire performance qualification as per ICS-Q2-R1 quantitative method validation guideline. A lot of other competitors in the market giving similar technology will also challenge and say we are also compliant to ICS-Q2-R1 validation guideline. But then the problem is they are compliant only with the limit guidelines. They are not compliant with the quantitative guideline. Why is that so? I'll explain in some moment. So what everyone gives in performance qualification is the accuracy, precision, linearity, LOD, LOQ. That's all. Nobody else apart from us in the TOC market gives the robustness and specificity, because the membrane conductimetric instrument can only pass it successfully the robustness and specificity. The direct conductivity based instrument are not able to pass the results of robustness and specificity, because these are challenging tests. And what is robustness? It's nothing but changing pH of the sample. Means the organic carbon content of sample is kept the same, but you change the sample condition. It can be temperature, it can be pH, it can be anything. So if you, for example, take pH as a criteria, for example, I have 500 ppb sucrose, but if I drop the pH to pH 3 instead of pH 7, in that case, the 500 ppb sucrose should ideally, your instrument, if it's robust, it should give 500 ppb result of carbon. It should not be influenced by change in pH. Whereas direct conductivity principle, as I explained how the technology works, it measures the final conductivity. Now, because the pH has been adjusted, what is pH? Lowering the pH means addition of H plus ions. Now, because of the additional H plus ions, the sensor, the conductivity cell, will read all the excess conductivity, and it will be not be able to give you the actual result of the organic carbon. It will misread, or it will show you over the limit, or it will show below zero as a result for the robustness test. So that's how it works, and that's the reason direct conductivity principle. Even we have one instrument working on that principle, and we also do not provide specificity and robustness as test for that specific model, because we know that direct conductivity principle instruments cannot pass it. And that's the reason we call such technologies as sensor technology, because it will just give an estimation and approximation. It will not give an exact value, because it is heavily influenced by the environment and the sample conditions. Whereas the membrane conductivity based principles, we call them as analyzers, because you can rely on the results, and it's actually the instrument validation is very comprehensive as per the Q2R1 quantitative method validation guideline, and even 1.25 of USP. So if I would like to just show you a section of JP. JP, I feel JP and KP are the most scientific oriented guidelines they have for the water testing in pharmaceutical. So JP 16 edition 2.59, which is chapter for organic carbon, total organic carbon testing, it says that the instrument should have a carbon dioxide separation block, as you can see. None of the technologies have this except the membrane conductivity principle, where you see that we are separating the carbon dioxide because of the membrane, and that part of the DI loop serves as a carbon dioxide separation block. It also says that a TOC, this is exactly statement by statement quoted from JP. It states that a TOC apparatus characterized by calculating the amount of organic carbon from difference in conductivity, which means it's talking about differential direct conductivity, the first animation that I showed you, before and after the decomposition of organic substance without separation of carbon dioxide from sample solution, may be influenced negatively or positively when applied to water specimens containing ionic organic substances, as I said, because of nitrates, sulfates, phosphates, and other halides present inside. And that's one of the key reasons why robustness test cannot be passed by such differential direct conductivity principle based analyzers. So this is something that I wanted to quote, because it's not only that every manufacturer will say that our instrument is better, but this is actually a regulation that I've quoted, where it states that what happens if you use a differential direct conductivity based principle instrument. So coming to the applications of TOC in pharmaceutical, the pharmaceutical applications, if you see, there are four main applications. The first is, and the most commonly used, is the water quality testing, and most commonly used pharmacopoeia is USP, which is chapter 643. Next comes an extension of that chapter, which is called as real-time release testing. This is more of a GMP practice. It's not as such a regulation, but then it's something definitely a company should think of if they want to increase their productivity. So it's again nothing but water testing, but it's an extension of the previous application. The third key application of TOC, which is gaining a lot of importance globally and also in Asia now, it's growing, which is cleaning validation. And the fourth one is the plastic packaging, the leachability and extractability study. So these are the key applications. Moving on to the first application is the ultra pure water application. We all know, I won't be discussing much in detail, we all know that TOC is one of the key tests for water. And why we monitor TOC is to check whether my source water is contaminated, or whether there is a failure in my purification system, or if there is any contamination in the purification and generation system. So what I've done is I've summarized all the pharmacopoeias, the key points, in a table. So most of the pharmacopoeias are having a limit of 500 ppb for TOC. only JB and KB are having different limits of 300 ppb for online testing, 400 ppb for offline testing. And as I said, I think JB and KB are more scientific as compared to others, because we all know that online TOC is always less than lab TOC because of the contamination and environment exposure. So that's the reason we have kept two different limits, one for online, one for offline. 500 is actually a very fictitious value. I have never seen a customer crossing 500 ppb for their water after purification. The system suitability compounds everywhere has been mentioned as sucrose and benzoquinone, and the logic of having two different compounds by USP, EP, IP and China Pharmacopoeia was that one easy to challenge the instrument with, one easy to oxidize and one difficult to oxidize, and check the combined recovery. Now there are a lot of cons in this proposal, because if one, maybe sucrose is easily recovered and the results are good, but benzoquinone, if it's not good, but the combined recovery still comes between 85% to 115%, and the result is passed. So that's kind of a very, I would say, a loose end for the customers. Whereas in JP and KP, they have just one system suit compound, and whether it's pass or fail, it's only because of it. And they have only one, which is actually difficult. Benzoquinone, if you see, the structure might look complex, but it's not actually a challenge to the instrument or the technology. SDBS is, on the other hand, is a big challenge to all the TOC. It's actually a very complex molecule. SDBS stands for sodium dodecyl benzyl sulfonate. So this is actually a big challenge. And if any instrument recovers this well within the limits, only then the system suit is passing. Only JP and KP has recommended the calibration standard should be KHP, whereas every other pharmacopoeia has kept it open. So what happens is a lot of TOC manufacturers, not lot, I would say every TOC manufacturer apart from us, are trying to propose the sucrose as a calibration standard, and also the system suit standard will have sucrose. So the main key criteria and logic of performing system suit and calibration is defeated here, because calibration will reset all your cell constants and everything in place. It will reset the instrument's values and give you the correct. But to check whether calibration is working fine or not, the system suit compound should be different from the calibration standard, right? If calibration is done by sucrose, you verify also with sucrose, the difference is never seen. So what KHP and JP and KP has said, that calibrate with KHP, verify with SDBS, only then you can see that your entire instrument is good to go ahead for use. So even we provide, whether it's because everyone else has kept it open, so that's the reason what we have done is we are providing KHP only to all our customers with all our instruments. And KHP is used as a calibration standard, and system suit compounds we do have all, depending on which customer is following which pharmacopoeia. So we have solutions for all. So now moving on to WHO GMP criteria for water testing. What they say is, based on WHO GMP TRS 970 Annex 2, they say that there has to be some of the key tests that should be done online, like flow pressure, temperature, conductivity, and TOC. And lab test can be done for physical, chemical, and microbiological attributes. So a lot of customers and companies I've seen who are WHO GMP compliant, who claim to be WHO GMP compliant, but they do not have online TOC. They just rely on the lab TOC results. But this is actually a published thing. I've given the reference here, TRS 970 Annex 2. You can download it. It's available in Google free of cost. So moving on to the next application, which is real-time release testing. As I said, it's an extension of the previous. It's water testing only, but then it is about mastering your productivity. It's about gaining the maximum efficiency. And this is definitely, I would say, of quite importance to a company who is having a vision to grow globally and who has already grown maybe, but then they would like to achieve the maximum productivity in what they do. Now, a big company or a mid-scale company, no matter how good their production and everything is, how will they increase their productivity? They can only increase their productivity by adapting some good practices, because they might be having world-class water system, they might be having world-class technology, they might be having world-class employees and engineers to be who are actually working. But then how to increase the productivity? The only way to increase the productivity is cut down the lab testing, go everything for online, for TUC, conductivity and other attributes which can be done online. So that's what FDA also claims in the PAP framework. It says that a risk-based approach has to be aligned, and real-time release testing is actually very helpful when you are thinking of moving forward in what you do. And real-time release testing, just having an online TOC doesn't suffice, because as we say that real-time release testing, it's not only real-time testing. Real-time testing and release testing is different. What happens, a lot of customers will have online TOC and lab TOC also. Online TOC is just used to see and estimate whether the water is within the range or not. So that's when I said that sensor instruments are majorly used. But to release the water or to use the water for manufacturing, they will always send the samples back in the lab. Now, what FDA and ASTM says, FDA as per the PAT framework says that why you send the samples back to the lab, instead have a robust TOC which is equivalent to or better as compared to a lab TOC which you are using to release it online itself, and just release the water online. So that's what FDA in the PAT initiative and ASTM in the section of E2656 has said, that instead of doing the lab testing to release, have a robust TOC instrument online. Now, what do I mean a robust TOC? Not any TOC in the online can replace the conventional testing that you're already doing. So, as I said, sensor-based instruments can only give you an approximation, which will say whether pass or fail. But to confirm it, you have to send the samples back in the lab. So the online system, as you can see here, is just showing you pass or fail criteria, but then an actual analyzer, if you have online, will give you exact data, exact figure, quantitative figure on which you can rely and take a call whether the result is pass or fail. So what ASTM 2656 say is that to control trend and monitor online systems and to release the water in real time using quantitative data, analytical method requires the use of quantitative data, so the analytical method shall be validated to the requirements of quantitative test. It clearly says that quantitative testing validation has to be done in order to qualify the online TOC as the instrument of record and release. You cannot just use any online TOC. Just having online TOC doesn't qualify you to release the water real time. So there are three basic steps if anyone would like to understand on how to release the water real time. The first is, if you want to move from the conventional testing of lab release to online release, it requires the evidence that the online and the lab instruments or the technologies are at par, or online technology is superior to the offline or the lab technology. Once that is proved, you have to do you have to choose the location of the online TOC based on the risk assessment by either the engineering team or the water system team, whosoever has supplied to the water system, and check the worst case area or the worst case or the most riskiest location where the TOC can be hooked up. And once that is done, the location and connection of the instrument shall reflect the quality of samples at point of use. And the last step also, which also shows about conductivity, where conductivity validation is also done, and TOC and conductivity can be used to release the water real time. So this is what I was talking about, sensors versus analyzers. So here we have done a comparative study, and earlier also we had a study from Lancaster Lab, where Lancaster Lab is a UK based laboratory, testing laboratory, who have published a comparative data of different technologies by running some samples. Now they used to run urea, and they used to run chloroform and acetone and other stuff. So when we showed that data, that our membrane based instruments are more robust and reliant as compared to the direct conductivity based instruments, a lot of customers used to say, but then in my water I won't find chloroform, I won't find nicotinamide, or I won't find acetone because my water is clean and pure. So what I did is we have our applications lab in Boulder, and we do have our instruments and even computer instruments. And what we did is we run the standards of pharmaceutical of all the pharmacopoeias. Now standards are something that all the TUCs will run definitely, but these standards were run not in standard mode but in sample mode. So when I introduce the standards as samples inside the instrument, you can see the change in recovery. Now, as we all know that, as we discussed in the previous slides, that KHP is the only standard suggested by JP and KP, whereas others have kept it open, we are calibrating with KHP. But when KHP is introduced as standard, as sample instead of standard, you can see the recovery. Ideal recovery is the red line, which is 100%. So what do I mean by 100% recovery? I prepare a 500 ppb sample, I inject it in the instrument, I should get 500 ppb. That is 100%. If I inject 500 ppb, I get 400 ppb, that is 80% recovery. So the blue one on the first is M9, and which is our instrument, and the green one is also 500 RL, which is our another model for water testing. So these two instruments are membrane based models, whereas all the other four instruments are direct conductivity based model. In this, the yellow one is also our model, which is direct conductivity based principle, which is a sensor instrument. As I said, we do have one sensor based instrument, but that was only to compete with the other TUC manufacturers in the market. So our two signature membrane based models are blue and green, as you can see, and ideally all the bars should be close to 100. So when we run KHP as sample, none of the DC based methods were able to recover even 50%, which means how can you, if a basic standard cannot be recovered when it is run as sample, you can understand how much reliable is the result which you are getting, because your water, even after purification, can have a lot of things, lot of small things that cannot be trapped by the membranes, right? It can have nitrates, sulfates, it can have phosphates, and a lot of other things present inside. When we run sucrose, as I said, sucrose is very, very easy to recover and it's not a challenge. So more or less all the technologies are recovering close to 100%. When we add the Japanese pharmacopoeia system suits sample as a sample, SDPS, close to 100 is only the blue, orange and the green. Rest other are overestimating. Now, why is overestimation? It's because of some other ionic, because one SDPS, when it breaks down, it gives a lot of sulfate ions. Now, as I said, the DC method, the direct conductivity based method, will measure any new ions formed. So with SDPS breaking down, there are sulfates, there are sulfate ions, and also the bicarbonate ions which are generated. And thus, these technologies overestimating the actual value. One for benzoquinone. This benzoquinone is a system suitability standard, and as you can see, the benzoquinone is also, it's not difficult. It's, though it's rated as one difficult to oxidize as per USPEP, it's not difficult to oxidize at all. So you can see all the technologies are recovering close to 100. And when I take a cocktail of KHP and benzo was already being recovered 100%, and when I just acidified the sample, when I just acidified, means it's benzoquinone 250 ppb, it's 250 ppb of KHP, equal proportions, total comes to 500 ppb. And just because of acidification, none of the technology is able to import, not even 1%. If, for example, benzo was recovered here 100%, if I'm using 250 ppb, it should at least show 50% of recovery. But because of just acidification, this is even not recovered 50%. It's not even 1% recovery that the other sensor-based instruments are showing. So these sensor-based instruments are failing miserably in the robustness test. This acidification is nothing but robustness. And robustness is one of the key tests of ICSQ2 R1 quantitative method validation guideline. So that's the reason I say that DC methods are called as sensors, whereas MC methods are called as analyzers. Now moving back to the real-time release testing, what is conventional testing and why should everyone move to real-time release testing? Is because what happens in conventional testing, you take offline samples, you send the samples to QC, and then you schedule your samples in queue. Then your sample is being analyzed and then the results are printed. and the results are entered into LIMS or result book, and then the quality person will review, approve and release the result. The results will be transferred to Trends and the product quality will review it and then send it after approving it, and then the water in the production is being used. So this causes a lot of delay, and there are actually duplication of steps which is happening here, which causes delay, and thus the productivity of any pharma company drops down. So this was again a thing to discuss about the sensor versus analyzer. So a lot, as I said, sensor will give you approximation, but these spikes that you see are not to be ignored, because if you have a reliable analyzer and if it gives this spike, it is actually something to be concerned about. Whereas sensors will keep giving you spikes after some time, and you will always try to ignore it, and you might actually miss it when there is actually something wrong in your water system. So what does real-time release testing help with? The limitations of traditional testing is that the sample sizes are less. What do I mean by sample sizes less? What is traditional testing? It's nothing but releasing the result based on lab TOC testing. So as you do only one test of in the lab for one water system, or maybe one point of use in a day or in a week, the sample size is very small. Whereas online, you will always have result every 15-20 minutes. So you have a very significant data in a day. In a day, you might have more than 40-50 data points. Contamination issues when you collect the sample and transport it to the lab. So the contamination can be because of sample handling. And there are delay because of sample analysis, and contamination can be environmental or it can be because of vial. The testing frequency is reduced, as I said, because of small sample size. The increased cost due to failure further into product manufacturing. And these are the key reasons why traditional testing should be avoided by any company. So what does real-time release testing offer? It gives you approval from days to minute, and it reduces your releasing time. It builds quality into your process. It increases process understanding and minimizes risk, because you understand the process better as compared to the lab testing, because you have a significant data and you can see the trends. You can see the trend and you can decide whether a trend is increasing or decreasing or it's flat. If it's increasing, definitely you can think and troubleshoot before anything goes out of hand. It saves a huge cost of lab testing, labor and time. It reduces the cost of consumables associated with lab testing, reduces grab sample analysis, and reduces the number of OOS investigations. Why? Because always lab TOC is higher than one. So moving on to the next application, which is plastic leachables and extractables. So I will just summarize this, because it has been enforced in 2016, but then it's still not applicable yet. But it's soon going to be effective for all the USP followers. So why plastic is being tested for leachables and extractables is because the plastic is the any formulation which is trapped in the plastic. Maybe you are manufacturing world-class formulation or world-class product, but then if it is packaged in a poor quality plastic container, with time it will leach something out, and the leaching of organics from the plastic is actually detrimental to the health of patient safety. And thus USP and even IP last year has suggested a chapter for plastic leachables and extractables. So this chapter further has sub chapters, which is 661.1 and 661.2. 661.1 is nothing but material screening. It is the evaluation of plastic system. So it is about the just the polymer, which is it can be HDPE, it can be PVC, it can be polypropylene, etc. Whereas 661.2 is about the entire system, wherein the plastic, because plastic is not just plastic, the polymer is mixed with some additives, coloring agents, stabilizers, and etc. So how it behaves in a system also has to be qualified. The limit for both has been decided. For TUC and TUC is one of the tests, if you see. Rest, there are several tests. TUC is one of the tests under physicochemical category. So the instrument requirement for TOC is that the instrument should have a LOD of 0.2 ppm and it should be able to demonstrate a linearity from 0.2 to 20 ppm. So this should be the basic criteria for any TOC which is used for this application. Same requirement goes for 661.2. And the limit is that after blank correction, it should not be more than 5 ppm for 661.1, which is only the polymer. Whereas for 661.2, which is the entire system with additives, coloring agents, and everything, it should not be more than 8 ppm. Even IPM 2018, as per chapter 6.2, has recommended the same criteria of testing for these kind of plastics. So moving on to the next application, which is cleaning validation application. So the first topic is identical method selection. So any method that you choose, as per FDA, what it states that there is no hard and fast that only HPLC should be used. You have a lot of options now for identical method. So it says, FDA says that whatever method you choose, it should be practical, achievable, verifiable, and defensible. So this is as per the briefed criteria of any method selection. So usually the methods that are very common is specific testing methods, and most common is HPLC and UV visible spectroscopy. Nowadays, even non-specific testing methods are gaining importance, and all the other regulatory bodies and consortiums are accepting it and promoting it that it should be done, because now it's not only limited to only active product. They have also, all the regulations are now saying that you should look for an overall cleanliness and not only a specific product which is cleaned or not. So specific method tells you how well you are cleaning your target residue only. Non-specific method tells you how well you are cleaning your entire product. So this is an example of what people used to do historically. They think that this is my production equipment and only API is the key contaminant in the next batch. But whereas API is a very small part in the entire formulation, it's only 5 to 10, 20% depending on what the formulation is. The rest 80 to 85% is nothing but the excipients which are present. And now once in the production equipment, you also add some cleaning agents. So those cleaning agents are also important to be removed from the production equipment. And it might also happen that your product, which is active product, is getting degraded when it is exposed to some harsh cleaning agents. And when you check it on specific methods like HPLC and UV visible, you won't be getting peak at that specific point, because your API might be present, but it got degraded, and once it gets degraded, the chemistry of the entire molecule changes. So this was actually proven by Danshin Dripping Pills. It's a Chinese medicine manufacturer, and in their patent study, it is a use study out of which one of them, they had demonstrated in a small part of their study, was that compare the specific methods like HPLC to TOC. In HPLC, based on 20 runs, you can decide based on this result. Till 14th run, there was no peak detected. 15th to 20th run, there was small peak, but this peak was less than LOQ. Based on this, you assume that the instrument is clean and there is no other contamination. But when the same samples were used and taken and inserted into the TOC instrument, you can see the TOC values. Except the second run, all the results are failing. This study showed that active product was present inside, but it got degraded because of cleaning environment, and thus it was not shown on the HPLC chromatogram, whereas it got captured on TOC, because in TOC, whether the product is entire or degraded, it gets captured easily. So this is how specific versus non-specific. I have summarized this section because it's a very comprehensive topic, and speaking and discussing on applications in just one call is not enough. But I wanted to show you a perspective of not the criteria and everything has changed properly. People have expanded their horizon, and they are also taking into consideration the cleaning agents, the degradants, the excipients, apart from just active product. We also have a application note, which is freely available on our website, where we are also comparing the cost of ownership of HPLC versus TOC. So there are different sections in it, and I have summarized it in one slide. That if you see the capital cost, which is instrument cost, TOC and HPLC both costs quite similar. So there is no major difference in cost of HPLC and TOC, but there is significant difference in the running and maintenance cost. So on the right, if you see table number 2, here you can see that the annual preventative maintenance cost of HPLC, if I consider it 100%, TOC maintenance cost is just 75% of the HPLC cost. That means you are saving 25% of the cost here. If we consider 7,500 measurements of workload in a year, or 7,500 samples in a year, HPLC will take an approximate 625 hours to achieve that, considering 20 minutes of method. Whereas TOC will take only 500 hours, so you save 125 hours, which is 20% of your time and labor, which can be used somewhere else, and you can increase your productivity in that way. And consumables, HPLC has a lot of consumables, so considering the consumable cost as 100%, the only consumable cost in TOC instruments is vials, and you are saving 19% here. So overall running and maintenance cost, if I say you are saving more than 23%, but if you also take the instrument cost into consideration, where there was no significant difference, the overall savings drops to 12%, but still 12% is a significant value when you are trying to save, cut cost, and at the same time increase the efficiency, reduce the time and other stuff. So coming to regulations that support and accept TOC, because everyone might say like, fine, we understand TOC is good, is effective, and is being accepted by everyone. So what are the regulations that accept TOC as a method? So first is US FDA. They do accept, this is available on their Q&A section in the website itself, and they say that TOC is suitable for quality assurance testing equipment release, USP water release, swab sampling, rinse sampling, CIP applications, and online process control. Moving on to the EU GMP Annex 15 and FIPS GMP Annex 15, they say that TOC and conductivity can be selected as testing methods for cleaning validation. ISP in 2011, in their CB guide, they published a cleaning validation guide. In that, there was a section on TOC. It says that it's another powerful tool for cleaning validation. TOC is a simple and very rapid method that can detect low levels of process residues of most pharmaceutical compounds, including those considered water insoluble. So there is again thinking amongst people that if my product is water insoluble and I can't use organic solvent in TOC, in that case I cannot use TOC. Well, solubility is a matter of solvent and solute interaction. And when we are talking about ppm levels, which is, and ppb level, which is mg in 1 liter or 1 microgram in 1 liter, in such low concentration, most of the products are soluble. Even if it's not soluble, there are various ways to solubilize a product. You can either decrease the pH, increase the temperature, do mechanical mixing, electronication, and stirring, and etc., and you can solubilize. So there are a hell lot of ways to solubilize any water insoluble product in water. And it says that TOC is very easy method to develop and should be the first choice when swab samples are required. And the last is PDA, Technical Report number 29 for Pharma, 49 for Biopharma. They say that specific methods for products is not usually an appropriate technique to determine whether the cleaning is effective or not. This is exact statement by statement taken from PDA, TR 29 and TR 49. Because of degradation of active ingredients in cleaning process of manufacturing, most common practice is to use TOC as identical procedure to indicate the removal of products, cleaning agents, excipients, and other potential contaminants. TOC can be used for all stages of cleaning validation, including design, qualification, validation, maintenance, as well as for investigations. So coming to the implementation of TOC, well, everything remains the same that you are currently doing. The only thing is you have to add an extra step of limit conversion, and that's a very small addition, and it's only a one-time addition. So whatever limit you were using on HPLC or UV visible spectroscopy, just multiply that limit with the percentage carbon of your worst case product on which the limit was calculated. So for example, my worst case product was ethanol. In ethanol, I have 52% carbon. How do I calculate 52% carbon? Is nothing but molecular weight of carbon divided by total molecular weight. So here the molecular weight of carbon was 24 divided by total molecular weight was 46. So it comes multiplied by 100 gives 52.1%. So if my HPLC limit was 1 ppm, I multiply with 0.52 and that gives me 0.52 ppm. So this is actually the TOC limit that you look forward to. Now, please note that the limit for TOC will always be lower than the HPLC, but it represents the same quantity of material. Why? Because TOC detects only carbon. So we have taken the same quantity of material, but we have taken only carbon into consideration. That's why the limit is less. But please keep in mind that if limit is less, it doesn't mean that it's reading less. It's reading the same quantity, but because it reads only carbon, we have multiplied with the percentage carbon. So coming to method comparison, well, most of the protocol remains the same. Now, well, sample preparation for HPLC is time consuming. TOC is no sample preparation run need until unless it's insoluble in nature. Identical method HPLC is complex. TOC is very simple to run and understand. Analysis time, it takes between 10 to 30 minutes, depends on method length. Whereas TOC, it takes less than 12 minutes. And proof of cleaning after doing so much is API only, whereas TOC, it gives information about all the compounds. Overall risk thus with HPLC is medium and with TOC is low. And method development also is very tedious and difficult and time consuming in HPLC. You might need 2 to 3 weeks to develop a method. You might need further 2-3 weeks to validate your method. So it takes almost 1-1.5 months to validate a method on a single product. Whereas in TOC, we have something called as auto reagent mode, which develops a method and gives you the developed method just in 30 minutes of time, less than 30 minutes of time. So you develop in 30 minutes, validate further in 1 hour max. In 1.5 hour, you are good to go. You're done with validation, you can start using TOC in routine verification of your samples. So if I have to compare, TOC methods are simple to develop, low cost of maintenance, fast analysis, streamlined equipment release, and captures a complete picture, not only just API. So just to summarize, thanks for being so patient, and I'm sorry for getting 2 minutes over the time, but we are done. This is the product spectrum that we have. As I said, we are just a TOC company, so it's not like other manufacturers where we manufacture one TOC and supply it in different application areas. We have different TOCs for different application areas. 500 RLE is for semicon and microelectronics. 500 RL is for the pharmaceutical online water testing. This is the membrane based model. Checkpoint is the sensor based model, but again for online testing is the DC based model. M9E is for again semicon industry. M9 laboratory is for lab cleaning applications and also water testing for lab. M9 online is for online cleaning applications. M9 portable is a hybrid between online and offline. It gives you the flexibility to either carry the instrument. It's just 9.5 kilos in weight. You can carry and take it to the production area or the shop floor, and you can just run the cleaning samples or swab samples right in the production area instead of sending the samples back in the lab. M5310C is for municipal applications, and this is for process and industrial applications. So as I said, we are just a TOC company, and that's why we specialize only in TOC products, and we have different products for different industries. We do have standards, consumables with respect to TOC. We also manufacture bulk standards, special standards. If anyone would like to get some special standards in a bulk, we do that. All our standards facility where the manufacturing happens are ISO 17025 certified. And the only thing that we do, we are the only company who gives the FAR report, which is failure analysis report. If at all our standards or our instruments fail, free of cost, we do the investigation and we give you a FAR report, because we understand that the compliance in pharmaceutical is very stringent and every failure has to be documented. So a letter from a manufacturer, if it's given, it will be very helpful during our audits. So we do that as well. And we have different vials. We have low TOC vials, duct vials, pre-acidified vials. Pre-acidified is usually used in biopharma industry, peptides and proteins are being used to increase the recovery, because usually proteins, peptides are sticky in nature and they tend to stick in the glass. So pre-acidification of the vials are done, wherein it will not allow the proteins and peptides to stick on the glass surface and thus give you a proper recovery that you expect. Duct vials are nothing but dual-use conductivity and TUC vials. So as I said, our TUC instrument comes also with an option of raw conductivity measurement. So in the same time of 2 minutes per repetition, you can get TUC and conductivity both the readings. Services, we offer complete service of IQ, OQ and PQ. We are completely 21 CFR part 11 compliant, and we also offer further VSPs like validation support packages and stuff. So you can contact the local CVOs distributor or the sales team, direct sales team if they are present, to get further information. So one instrument, multiple compliances. We comply with USP, TOC and conductivity, 661 testing of plastic leachable extractable. We do the method validation as per USP and ICSQ2R1. We comply with GP, because as per GP, you need a CO2 separation block in the instrument. So we do have that. We comply with cleaning validation application requirement. We are completely 21 CFR part 11 compliant. And all the basic pharmacopoeia. So thanks everyone. We would like to open the segment for question and answer.
Look at the questions that we have in store. But before that, Rohit, can I please have you on with us? Can you please put on the mic? Welcome, Rohit. So Rohit, should we go ahead with the first question?
Yeah, sure. So for offline testing of water samples for water conductivity and TOC, how long can I store samples before testing? Well, this is a very good question. And I would like to say that if you would like to do conductivity and TOC both together in one vial, there are a few considerations that you have to be prepared of. So the first thing is, conductivity samples are not stable in glass vials. So if you are collecting the conductivity samples in glass, the sodium and the silicate ions will leach out and it will increase the conductivity with time. So even after 60 minutes, the sample conductivity will go up, and with more time, if the sample is in glass, it will increase the conductivity continuously. Whereas for TOC, the sample is actually stable in glass and not in plastic. Whereas for conductivity, as I said, it's not stable in glass, but it's stable in plastic. So this is a very dicey situation. So what we have come up with in Sivers is, we have made a special vial, which is called as duct vial, DUCT, which is called as dual use conductivity and TOC vials. So these vials are glass vials, but the internal side of the glass vial is coated with inert chemical is coated inside. And because of which the water sample is not allowed to now contact with glass, and thus the sodium and the silicate ions cannot leach out in your sample and increase the conductivity. At the same time, the TOC is also stable. So with the duct vials, you can store the sample for 5 days without a significant increase in TOC and conductivity. Whereas for normal glass vials, conductivity samples every 60 minutes or 45 minutes will show you increase, whereas TOC samples can be stored for around 12 to 24 hours, depends on the storage conditions again.
All right, thank you for answering that question. Can we have the next question, please? Right, the next question for you, Rohit.
So stage 2 conductivity is only supposed to be done when stage 1 is failed. So stage 1 conductivity, usually 90% of the customers, if they have a robust environment and a robust instrument, passes the stage 1 conductivity. And only if the stage 1 is failing, stage two has to be done.
All right, all right. The next question, please. Yes.
We are released water for use by performing microbial testing on water from a sample port. Well, for releasing water to be used, it depends if you are manufacturing purified water or water for injection. So if it's water for injection, the four basic tests that is required to be done by USP is TOC, conductivity, bioburden, and endotoxin. So all the four tests has to be done if it's water for injection. If it's only purified water, TOC and conductivity alone are enough to be released for use of water for the manufacturing process.
All right, thank you for that response. The next question, please. Yeah, the next question.
What is the main reason for KCl addition in water conductivity test for pH measurement? Yeah, so KCl is usually added as is to the main use of this KCl in conductivity testing is not for pH measurement as such, but it's actually to calibrate and verify the sensors, the conductivity cells that you have. So K, when the KCl dissociates, it dissociates into K plus and Cl minus ions. So both positive and negative ions are present, and that is actually used for verification and calibration of your conductivity cells.
Right. All right. Now, before we take up another question, one small question from my side as well. Are you launching any new products in the coming year?
Yeah, we are coming up with bacterial endotoxin testing instrument, and this is a completely revolutionary product, and it's a completely different technology as compared to the conventional the endotoxin monitors or instruments that we have. Mm-hmm. In our instrument that we are coming up with, it's using less than 90% of the current LAL reagent, the limulus amebocyte lysate. So these lysates are actually taken out from the limulus amebocyte crabs. It's actually the horseshoe crabs, the limulus crabs, and in them they have the cells called as amebocytes.
Right.
So it's taken from there, and it's actually these crabs are endangered, and thus we came up with an idea of why not come up with a different approach from rest of the conventional endotoxin instruments that we have. Why not use less LAL? Because as of now, LAL is something that is mandatory for endotoxin use, though we have the other new additions in the regulations, which is fluorescence based. But then LAL is the age-old method, and we have to use it. But why not reduce it by 90%? So we are just using 10% of the current LAL consumption by the customers. And also the pipetting steps, our entire process is semi-automatic. So pipetting steps, if you see, is approximately 242 pipetting steps. Mm-hmm. In our instrument, we are done with just 27 pipetting steps. And that is significantly reducing the errors, because each pipetting step is going to add some amount of error in your reading. So right. Manual labor is less, error is less, environment friendly, everything. So we are coming up with this instrument in December in Asia. It's already launched in US and Europe. Yeah.
Okay. Great. So I think the people will look forward to that, so that works becomes less tedious now, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So let's see if we have any other questions left. Yes, a last question for you. I think we've already done this, right?
Yeah, can I? Okay. Do water conductivity and TOC testing online? Yes, you can do it online. Our instruments that we have for online TOC measurement also comes with an option of choosing conductivity if you would like to. So it's not that you have to install two different instruments online. You can choose our one instrument and you can opt for the optional conductivity parameter as well. And at the same time, it's not going to take even additional time. At the same time, it is going to give you conductivity and TOC readings online.
Great. Thank you so much for all your responses, Rohit. I think we're done with the questions. In case there are a few pending questions, we'll share it with you and we get the responses anyhow, right? Okay. Thank you so much for sharing all the information, Rohit. Thank you.
Thanks. Bye. Thanks, everyone, for attending it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.